Okay, so you've been asking me again and again how to read financial statements. So first of all, you have to be able to find them. Let me show you how to do it. This is a company I'm looking at right now. It's called VMware. So what you usually do is you go on their website and you click Investor Relations. Now, once you hit the website, you actually hit the Investor Relations section, it's going to be hella confusing. What you want to click is not financial information. You want to click SEC filings, which is this thing right here. You click on SEC filings, and then you want to find the latest quarterly reports, which in this case is the 10-Qs. This was filed on December 7th. And I usually like to open up the PDF version of it. That's how I get to the nice, comfortable form of these financials. Now, this company, by the way, is a company that does cloud computing and virtualization services, essentially providing companies with virtual cloud servers. They're in a very good environment. Main competitor is Cisco. Interesting company, actually. I'm doing a lot of research on them right now, but for this purpose of this video, we're just going to look at the financials. So first of all, let's attack these financials. The first thing I want to see is what's going on with the revenue. So I'm going to take a look at this line and at this line. So the first thing you're going to see here is that this is actually in thousands for shares and in millions for amounts. It's really important because when you see 2,800, it means that it's 2.8 billion. So these are all billions. Every single thing here is billions. This is for the 9 months ending on Q3 this year. This is Q3 last year. And this is a 3 month snapshot this year and last year. Okay. So now we have our kind of boundaries of where we're going with this. Now, the first thing I'll notice here is that we have a steady growth of 10%, 9 months over 9 months, and 3 months over 3 months. So it's almost like a systematic growth of 10%. 10% per quarter year over year and 10% year over year. So it's not a huge amount, but it's a steady growth. Now, the other thing I want to watch here is that I'm seeing a decline in license fees, but I'm seeing a major spike in SaaS. SaaS, by the way, if you don't know what it's SaaS, it's software as a service. So as I mentioned earlier, a lot of these companies are moving away from selling licenses to actually selling services which are scalable and don't require almost no investment in cost of goods, as I'm about to show you. So as I can see here from the reports, I can really see that they're shifting away from licenses to SaaS, which is a good shift. It means that they've initiated a process that's going to increase their profitability, but probably their share price is not reflective of that yet, which is a huge opportunity. But that's not that kind of video. That's usually how I think about it. So the first thing I want to take a look at here is the profitability. I'm going to take a look at these numbers, the 9 months and the 3 months. And I'm going to use these numbers, which are the cost of goods, to find out what their gross margin is. And if you do the math later, you'll see that it's about 80%. So 80% gross margin is actually very good. And if you scroll all the way down here, you'll see that they're operating at about 15% to 16% EBITDA, which is not bad. EBITDA, by the way, it's earning before income tax, depreciation, amortization. So 80% gross, 16% net, not bad at all. That means it's a healthy company. We have a 10% growth and quite steady. So that's actually very healthy as far as the profitability of the company. Now, the other thing I want to take a look at here is what happened over time with certain expenses. So you can see here that their sales and marketing actually reduced from last year. And you know me, I don't like to see a lot of sales and marketing expenses. However, R&D increased significantly. So a company that increases R&D, decreases marketing expenses is a company I specifically like. And the other thing I want to show you here is kind of interesting. If you scroll down here, is what they actually have in the cash register. So this is as a snapshot for October 30th. So they do have 3.9 billion in cash. However, pretty much everything else you'll see here, This is also pretty much cash. Let me explain what I mean. So you have 3.9 in cash. Accounts receivable means how much cash they're supposed to get from their clients, which they have not collected yet. So this is pretty much cash. Now, this is the same, but this is from Dell. They have a parent company called Dell. You probably heard about it. So it has to be separate, but it's pretty much the same thing. Dell owes them $670 million, which they have to repay them for services and whatnot. And this number, 473 other current assets, not sure what it is. So for the most part, about 6.4 out of the 6.8 billion is money. So 6.5 billion, this is pretty much cash in one way or the other. That's a very good situation to be in, especially given the fact that their assets versus liabilities are not that amazing. So from a first glance here, you'll see that they have assets of 27 billion versus 18 billion in liabilities. So it seems that they have quite a lot of assets over liabilities, but you'll notice here that a lot of it is goodwill. Now, what is goodwill? About 10 billion is goodwill. Now, goodwill is a meaningless number. Goodwill is a number that is not going to allow you any depreciation or amortization. You're not going to get any tax benefits out of it. It's just there as an asset, but it really helps you in no way, shape, or form. It's not cash. You can do nothing with it. So realistically, they have 17 billion in assets and 18 billion in liabilities. However, what I like to look at here, and I'll explain in a second what goodwill is, because they have so much cash, 6.5 billion in cash, and their debt, the actual money they have to repay, and the note is right here, long-term debt is 4.7 billion. I'm quite comfortable with this. They have a note, Dell, about 270 million. So as far as their debt, they have more cash than their debt, even though the liabilities are bigger than the assets minus the goodwill, which you need to neutralize. Now, what is goodwill? How does this come here? Goodwill is something, let's say that you're buying a company, which they did. They bought a company called Pivotal. So once you buy a company, you have to allocate the money that you paid for that company for assets. And if this company is a services company, it means that its value is not directly linked to actual, you know, machinery or stuff you can actually link money to. So whatever you can't link money to, and basically you have to allocate, you have to do a price purchase allocation. It's getting complicated. I'll try to keep it simple, but you have to do a PPA. And basically you have to say, okay, each dollar went to what? Why did I pay this money? And whatever you can't allocate money to, let's say you paid $100 million for Pivotal and only $20 million in actual assets that you can actually find. But you say, okay, but the other amount, the other $80 million, they're worth it because they're generating so much cash flow from their services. They're worth that extra $80 million. In that case, then in this case, the accounting principles are saying, okay, then no problem. So that means you paid $80 million on goodwill, on their ability to generate cash. So it gets allocated to goodwill as an asset, but you cannot depreciate it, you cannot amortize it, you cannot use it. So it's basically a meaningless number. So that's, it's not as good as it seems. It's not as bad as it seems. They have plenty of cash, which means they're sort of on an equilibrium, an equal amount of cash and liabilities. And assets, or sorry, assets and liabilities, if you neutralize this number and you take into account how important this number versus these numbers. So this is unearned revenue, not important. We're looking at the debt here, 4.7 billion. Now, okay, this is actually another asset I forgot to take a look at. Okay, so apart from this, this is also a cash flow item. 5.8 billion is called deferred tax assets. It basically means that they have what you would call a taxable shield. Essentially, let me give an example. If you accumulated tax attributes in previous years, you can utilize them to reduce the tax bill that you have in a certain year where you have a lot of profits. So that thing actually is worth a lot of money. This is as well intangible assets. They get depreciated. It's called amortization. So that's worth a lot of money as well. And on the debt side, I'd like to add these numbers: 270 million that they owe to Dell, 4.7, which is the debt, and 800 that they actually owe in tax. So when you add these up, you pretty much get about 6 billion, which is what they have in cash, which is a good balance for me. I mean, good enough. It's not amazing, but it's good enough. Now, the next part you have to look at when you're looking at financials is this other information. It sounds so insignificant. Other information. Usually the biggest gems and gold nuggets are in this other information. This is where people hide all the good stuff. So right now we have legal proceedings. That is a must. We have to understand the legal proceedings. We have to understand the risk factors of this company, which are quite a few. So let's get started. First of all, they have COVID-19. Of course, that's a risk, but we're not going to dwell on that. Customer acceptance of our newer products and services. That's kind of generic. Significant decrease in demand or server virtualization project. Basically, that this is all standard stuff. I mean, if the demand goes down, their business goes down. Okay, this is quite interesting. We face intense competition that could adversely affect our operating results. This is important. Okay. The virtualization container, cloud computing, end-user computing, security, and software-defined data center industries are interrelated and rapidly evolving, and we face intense competition. Well, what they mean here, essentially, let me just translate it to plain English, is that all these major players are moving into this server virtualization business. So if I'm Amazon, or I'm Google, or I'm Oracle, I'm bundling this virtualization service with my massive other suite of services I'm selling to these B2B clients. It's a major risk. So right here, you'll see that they're explaining how they handle that risk. And right here, if you read this paragraph, which I'm not going to because it's highly technical, what they're saying is that they're actually partnering with these same competitors to basically avoid competition by working with AWS, for example, and Microsoft. Many of these cloud providers are partnering with on-premises hardware vendors to deliver their cloud platform as an on-premises solution, including AWS Outpost and Azure Stack. So in fiscal 2018, we entered into a strategic alliance. This is really smart. With AWS to deliver vSphere. vSphere is actually a product by this company, VMware, or cloud services. So essentially, they're working with Amazon. Instead of competing with Amazon, they're now actually cooperating, selling their stuff as an integrated product inside AWS and inside Google and inside the Oracle stuff, as you can see right here. So right now, just based on reading this risk factor, we actually understood that the market is extremely crowded and how this company actually got out of this impossible fight by basically, if you can't beat them, join them. Very smart. And that all we just learned by just browsing through the financials. Now, the other part I want to show you here is the legal proceedings, if you can find it right here. Okay, litigation. So right now we have here a lawsuit by a shareholder. It's a class action lawsuit. Basically, anytime you have an M&A deal, which they had here, they acquired Pivotal, there's going to be lawsuits. Shareholders are going to be suing for whatnot reasons. I mean, it's a pretty boilerplate lawsuit by a shareholder on an M&A deal. However, this one actually is really important, and you won't see it unless you dig into this. This is a lawsuit from 2018 where the company actually lost a patent infringement lawsuit, and they were ordered to pay $237 million in damages. It's a lot of money. It's really impactful for the company. However, here they're saying that they're appealing the decision, and the appeal is going to take a while, and they're going to battle it out and whatnot. But you have to understand that even though they take out a provision in this, in their financials, however, it's a cash flow thing. If they actually have to pay it, $237 million will come out of the cash register, even though the provision is already there. It's going to have a major impact on their cash flow. However, having said all that, when you're comparing $230 million to $6.8 billion pretty much in cash or almost cash, it's not a massive amount. Let's be honest. These are sizable companies. So this is really not scary to me, but I'd like to be aware of that. And yeah, that's the whole thing. And I'd rather teach you how to fish than just, you know, give you fish. So I'd rather teach you how to do this than, you know, hide this behind a paywall, pretend that like this is like rocket science and only I can do it. I want you guys to be able to do it yourself as well. And I hope I achieve that. Let me know below if you appreciated this video, if you want more breakdowns like this. And I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.